Welcome to the Back to the 40s podcast. We are a group of recovered alcoholics who love to share the history of the AA program. We are students of the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. We really believe in the program outlined in the book and want to share it with anyone who may be afflicted with the disease of alcoholism. These five classes will take us through the 12 steps right out of the Big Book as they did in the early days of AA. If you want more information about these classes, please email us at backtothe40s@gmail.com. That's backtothe40s@gmail.com. Or visit our website, backtothe40s.podbean.com. And in both those cases, it's all letters, no numbers. This is the last class in the sequence, and we have really covered a lot. This week, we will finish strong with step 10, 11, and 12. Let's grab our big book, and let's join Michael, Nick, and Bob as they get class rolling.
Good morning. I'm an alcoholic, and my name is Michael.
Hi, Michael.
I'm a recovered alcoholic, contingent on the maintenance of my spiritual condition. Let's have a moment of silence to reflect on why we're here, followed by the Serenity Prayer. God,
grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference.
We'd like to welcome you to the fifth and final class of the Beginners Meetings, How Alcoholics Anonymous worked in the 1940s. More than 60 years ago, after the publication of the Big Book, the recovery rate from alcoholism within the Fellowship of AA was at about 75%. AA's program as practiced then was quite different from the program that is practiced today. That is, the AA program is unchanged, but the way this practice has changed. To produce such an astounding recovery rate, what was done in the early days of AA? Well, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take an in-depth look how Alcoholics Anonymous worked in the mid-1940s. I've asked Mick to read the AA preamble that has appeared in the first edition of the Big Book in 1939, and it reads,
"We are not an organization in the conventional sense of the word. There are no fees or dues whatsoever. The only requirement for membership is an honest desire to stop drinking. We are not allied with any particular faith, sect, or denomination, nor do we oppose anyone. We simply wish to be helpful to those who are afflicted."
Hello, our names are Bob,
Michael,
and Mick.
And we are recovered alcoholics, and that is contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition daily. We are not experts, nor are we authorities on the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. We are recovered alcoholics who love to study the Big Book. Any commentary that is made throughout this study is just our opinions based upon our interpretation of the Big Book. We do not need to open our books at this time, but we will let you know. On page 164 of the Big Book, it reads,
"Our book is meant to be suggestive only. We realize we know only a little. God will constantly disclose more to you and to us."
Before we begin this class, we'll need to address one more thing. There is always going to be controversy when it comes to this book and its message for one reason or another. Some will say it needs to be rewritten, changed, or updated, and then there is the God issue, that it is written in the male gender and a whole lot of other controversial issues. It's as if we are saying the book should be changed to meet our own personal agendas. On page Roman numeral 11, the book tells us,
"There exists a sentiment against any radical changes being made in it."
The point is, let's leave the book alone and change our own attitudes towards the book, and from that perspective, learn the recovery program that produced a 75% success rate back in the 1940s. This is how the presentation of these classes will work.
I will read from the 1944 pamphlet. We can listen to what is being read, take notes, and if you have any questions, write them down. Submit them to your sponsor, or see one of us after the meeting and discuss them at length.
I will read excerpts from the Big Book, and you will follow along using the line book markers.
I will read commentary to what is studied and give directions, page numbers, line numbers, or paragraph numbers. This is how these classes are taught. Now listen carefully as Michael reads a very interesting item.
This is class 5, and would you please close your eyes and listen, use your imagination while listening, and take the following information into your heart and soul. This is titled, "I Am Your Illness." I hate meetings, I hate higher power. I hate anyone who has a program. To all who come in contact with me, I wish you death and I wish you suffering. Allow me to introduce myself. I am the illness of alcoholism. Cunning, baffling, and powerful. That's me. I have killed millions. I am pleased. I live to catch you with the element of surprise. I love pretending I am your friend and lover. I have given you comfort, have I not? Wasn't I there when you were lonely? When you wanted to die, didn't you call me? And I was there. I love to make you hurt. I love to make you cry. Better yet, I love when I make you so numb you can neither hurt nor cry. You can't feel anything at all. This is true glory. I will give you instant gratification, and all I ask you is long-term suffering. I've been there for you always. When things were going right in your life, you invited me. You said you didn't deserve these good things, and I was the only one who would agree with you. Together, we were able to destroy all things good in your life. People don't take me seriously. They take strokes, heart attacks, even diabetes seriously, fools that they are. They don't know that without my help, these things would not be made possible. I am such a hated illness, and yet I do not come uninvited. You choose to have me. So many have chosen me over reality and peace. I, more than you, hate me. I hate all of you who have a 12-step program, your meetings, your higher power, all weaken me and I can't function in the manner I'm accustomed to. Now I must lie here quietly. You don't see me, but I'm growing bigger than ever. When you only exist, I may live. When you live, I only exist. But I am here until we meet again. If we meet again. Till then, I wish you death and suffering. And this is another one. This is called, this is what you'd get if 99.9% is good enough. It says repeat. This is what you'd get if 99.9% is good enough. I had my tongue over my eye tooth. I couldn't see what I was saying. 200,000 incorrect drug prescriptions per year. 16,000 pieces of mail lost by the U.S. Postal Service each hour. 70 incorrect surgical operations each day. 13 newborn babies dropped at birth by doctors each day. 22,000 checks deducted from the wrong bank accounts each hour. 103 missed heartbeats per person per day. 10 minutes without electricity, water, heating, cooling, telephones, including traffic lights, each week. 10 commercial airline crashes per day. Oh, and by the way, not to mention, no AA and no sobriety.
Yeah, baby. Welcome to the fifth and final class of Back to the 40s, how Alcoholics Anonymous worked in the 1940s. We have been taking the steps as they were taken back in the 40s. Our teacher has been the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous, which is our text for recovery. We've learned earlier that we were suffering from an illness which only a spiritual solution will conquer. We are well on our way to that spiritual awakening, which will produce the personality change that will bring about our recovery from alcoholism. Before we get into this class, which is about the growth steps 10, 11, and 12, let's look at our progress so far. In the first class, we made two admissions.
Number one,
that we were alcoholic.
Number two,
that we could not manage our lives. And we learned we have a physical allergy and a mental obsession, an illness called alcoholism, and the only relief is entire abstinence. In the second class, we answered two questions.
Number one,
were we willing to believe in a power greater than ourselves, even though it was impossible for any of us to fully define or comprehend that power, which is God?
And number two,
were we willing to surrender ourselves to whatever concept we had of God? We learned that God was within us and we needed to make contact with Him. Also, we discovered the things that were blocking us off from God, and we explored the paramount importance of sitting in counsel with God and another, sharing our life story. In the third and fourth class, we learned that the work begins here. We had to have God's help and all of his loving advisors through the rest of the steps if we were going to change for the better. Also, we learned we must make restitutions for harm done, do our part in eliminating our defects of character and shortcomings. So this is where we are tonight.
First, step 10.
We are going to learn about personal inventory.
Second, step 11.
We are going to learn about contact with God.
Third, step 12.
We are going to explore the exact, precise result of the 12 steps. At this time, pass out the central bulletin, hand out the article as evidence. The early AAs told us to take steps 1 through 9 once, and to take steps 10, 11, and 12 daily for the rest of our lifetime. Steps 1 through 9 bring us into recovery and get us sober. They do not keep us sober. Steps 10, 11, and 12 keep us sober through spiritual principle of perseverance.
Which is step 10.
The spiritual principles of awareness and belief.
Which is step 11.
The spiritual principles of love and service.
Which is step 12.
That's how it was done back in the 1940s, and it worked. Consider this. In Chapter 5, How It Works, pages 59 and 60, the 12 steps are displayed. If we look closely, we will find some interesting facts. Notice the words continued, sought and improved, carry and practice. These key actions in steps 10, 11, and 12 are daily reprieve. As the book calls it, are actions that we do in the now time frame. According to the big book, we do steps 1 through 9 and then do steps 10, 11, and 12 for the rest of our lifetime. Let's listen to step 10 from the 1944 pamphlet.
Continue to take personal inventory, and when we are wrong, promptly admitted it. In coming to AA, we usually will have a pretty big inventory to work on, as in steps 4, 8, and 9. But even after that, we will not be perfect. We have a long way to go. We will continue to make mistakes and will be inclined to do some more wrong thinking, wrongdoing. So at intervals, we continue to take inventory. Here, the purpose is to check on our progress. We certainly cannot be perfect, so the need for regular inventory is apparent. These inventories are personal. We confine the inventory to ourselves. We are the ones who need it. Never mind the other fellow. He too is probably troubled and will have to make his own inventory. When we make these inventories, probably the best way to start is to go over one by one each of the 12 steps and try to discover just what in these steps we are not following. The businessman has to make a physical inventory from time to time, so we have to make a personal inventory of ourselves from time to time if we want to recover from a serious mental illness. Let's open our books to page 84, line 16. For step 10, and here we have a timeline. This is the step 10, again, page 84, line 16.
Chapter 6, Into Action.
This thought brings us to step 10, which suggests...
And here we have, beginning with the next line, the explanation of step 10, which reads...
We continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. We vigorously commence this way of living as we cleaned up the past. We have entered the world of the Spirit.
Followed by the 10th step requirements.
Our next function is to grow in understanding and effectiveness.
Another timeline tells us.
This is not an overnight matter. It should continue for our lifetime.
Next, we are given the 10th step directions.
Continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear.
Which is step 4.
When these crop up, we ask God at once to remove them.
Which are steps 6 and 7.
We discuss them with someone immediately.
Which is step 5.
And make amends quickly if we have harmed anyone.
Which is steps 8 and 9. Remember, from page 77, line 3, we studied that our real purpose is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. Continue reading, same line.
Then we resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. Love and tolerance of others is our code.
The 10th step is actually using the following steps daily as needed, step 4 through 9. This daily action, through the spiritual principle of perseverance, provides growth in understanding and effectiveness in our personal lives. This is how God wants us to live, to stay sober and to keep spiritually, mentally, emotionally, socially, and physically fit. To live to good purpose under all conditions on an ongoing basis. And as the precise result of this daily actions of step 10, this is what happens. The 10th step promises. Go to the last paragraph on the same page. Here we have the 10th step promises.
And we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even alcohol, for by this time sanity will have returned.
This is where step 2 is completed. We are restored to sanity. So we don't really take step 2. Step 2 takes us. Our belief and hope in God has paid off. Let's continue reading the 10th step promises, same line, same page.
We will seldom be interested in liquor. If tempted, we recoil from it as if a hot flame. We react sanely and normally, and we will find that this has happened automatically. We will see that our new attitude towards liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. It just comes. That is the miracle of it. We are not fighting it. Neither are we avoiding temptation. We feel as though we have been placed in a position of neutrality, safe and protected. We have not even sworn off. Instead, the problem has been removed. It does not exist for us. We are neither cocky nor are we afraid. That is our experience. That is how we react, so long as we keep in fit spiritual condition.
And here we have a warning. Remember that our lives are always in the balance. Go to the next paragraph, same page.
It is easy to let up on the spiritual program of action and rest on our laurels. We are headed for trouble if we do, for alcohol is a subtle foe. We are not cured of alcoholism. What we really have is daily reprieve contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition. Every day is a day when we must carry the vision of God's will into our own and all our activities. How can I best serve thee? Thy will, not mine, be done. These are thoughts which must go with us constantly. We can exercise our own willpower along this line if we wish, if it is the proper use of the will.
We gave our will and our lives over to the care of God in step 3, when we decided to go through the steps. Now in step 10, He gives our will and our lives back because we know what to do, to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. We cannot stay sober on the past actions we took in steps 1 through 9. The steps that brought us this far, we cannot keep sober on yesterday's spiritual experiences. We must create new spiritual experiences daily. So this fit spiritual condition is only temporary. The daily action of step 10 is one-third of the way to create that temporary condition. One-third of the precise way to a daily reprieve. Let's take step 10 together. For all of those who have done the work so far, we can now take step 10 by repeating the quote on page 85, lines 19 and 20. How can I best serve thee? Thy will, not mine, be done. This is step 10. That 10th step alone won't keep this fit spiritual condition. Stay on page 85, look for the next to the last paragraph. Here the book gives us a summary or an overview of where we are in the recovery process.
Much has already been said about receiving strength, inspiration, and direction from Him who has all knowledge and power. If we have carefully followed directions, we have begun to sense the flow of His Spirit into us. To some extent, we have become God-conscious. We have begun to develop this vital sixth sense. But we must go further, and that means more action.
So, in summary of everything we have done, steps 1 through 10, the book tells us, if we have carefully followed these precise directions, we will have received the following spiritual gifts: strength, inspiration, direction, knowledge, power, His Spirit, God consciousness, and have begun to develop this vital sixth sense. The timeline says we must go further, more action. Let's move on to step 11 and listen as Michael reads Step 11 from the 1944 pamphlet.
Step 11. Sought through prayer and meditation to prove our conscious contact with God as we understand Him, praying only for knowledge of His will for us and the power to carry that out.
Let's consider these three points. Point number one.
We pray each night, every night, a prayer of thanks.
Point number two.
We pray each morning, every morning, for help and guidance.
Point number three.
When we are lonely, confused, uncertain, we pray. Most of us find it well to.
And here we have eight items to consider. Number one.
Choose for each day a quiet time to meditate on the program, on your progress in it.
Number two.
Keep conscious contact with God and pray to make the contact closer.
Number three.
We pray that our will be laid aside and that God's will direct us.
Four.
Pray for calmness, quiet, relaxation, rest.
Number five.
Pray for strength and courage to enable us to do today's work today.
Number six.
Pray for forgiveness for yesterday's errors.
Seven.
Ask for hope for better things tomorrow.
Eight.
Pray for what we feel we need. We will not get what we want. We will get what we need. What is good for us? Let's look at Step 11 in the Big Book, last paragraph, page 85, and here we have some more requirements. These are definite and valuable requirements.
Step 11 suggests prayer and meditation. We shouldn't be shy on this matter of prayer. Better men than we are using it constantly.
Next, we have one of the many promises given us as we explore Step 11. Let's continue with the same line.
It works if we have the proper attitude and work at it.
Next, on the same line, the book warns us not to take this lightly, that prayer and meditation are precise and of major importance.
It would be easy to be vague about this matter, yet we believe we can make some definite and valuable suggestions.
Prayer and meditation is simply spending time with God as you understand it. Prayer is talking with God. Meditation is listening to God. Prayer and meditation is putting God in on everything. So, what is our part or purpose in doing this prayer and meditation daily? To gain wisdom, to know the difference between God's will for us and our will for us. To feed ourselves with spiritual nourishment and to allow God to guide us. The sentiment down through the ages has been summed up in the saying, pray, P-R-A-Y, or be pray, P-R-E-Y. So these are the directions on how to continue to build our way to being spiritually fit for one day. Let's continue to look at Step 11. Notice that the book is directing us to Steps 10, 11, and 12. And here we have a timeline explanation, requirements, and directions to create that daily reprieve. Begin with page 86, line 5.
When we retire at night, we constructively review our day.
Next is Step 4.
Where were we resentful, selfish, dishonest, or afraid?
Followed by Steps 8 and 9.
Do we owe an apology?
And next we have Step 5.
Have we kept something to ourselves which should be discussed with another person or our sponsor at once?
And the following questions are all Step 4.
Were we kind and loving toward all? What could we have done better? Were we thinking of ourselves most of the time? Or were we thinking of what we could do for others? Of what we could pack into the stream of life?
And here we have a warning.
But we must be careful not to drift into worry, remorse, or morbid reflection, for that would diminish our usefulness to others.
Next we have Step 6 and 7 and the forgiveness prayer.
After making our review, we ask God's forgiveness and inquire what corrective measures should be taken.
The paragraph we just studied is actually Step 10, which, as we read earlier, is Steps 4 through 9 daily as needed. Next, we have another timeline and some more direction. Next paragraph, same page. Again, let us remind ourselves to just follow along, moving across and down the page a little bit at a time.
On awakening, let us think about the 24 hours ahead. We consider our plans for the day before we begin.
And here we have the thinker's prayer.
We ask God to direct our thinking, especially asking that it be divorced from self-pity, dishonest, or self-seeking motives.
Next, we have a promise, one of the many results from Step 11.
Under these conditions, we can employ our mental faculties with assurance.
followed by a major requirement.
To offer all God gave us springs to use.
Another promise.
Our thought life may will be placed on a much higher plane when our thinking is cleared of wrong motives.
Next, we have another timeline and some more directions. Last paragraph, same page, page 86.
In thinking about our day, we may face indecision. We may not be able to determine which course to take.
Here we have the indecision prayer.
Here we ask God for inspiration, an intuitive thought or a decision.
More requirements.
We relax and take it easy. We don't struggle.
Another promise.
We are often surprised how the right answers come after we had tried this for a while.
Let's continue our study of step 11. Page 87, line 1, and here we have another promise.
Again, that is on page 87, line 1, and it reads,
what used to be the hunch or the occasional inspiration gradually becomes a working part of the mind.
Now we have a warning.
Being still inexperienced of having just made conscious contact with God, it is not probable that all we are going to be inspired at all times, but we might pay for this presumption in all sorts of absurd actions and ideas.
Followed by a promise.
Nevertheless, we find that our thinking will, as time passes, be more and more on the plane of inspiration. We come to rely upon it.
Next paragraph on the same page, we have another timeline and some more precise direction.
We usually conclude with the period of meditation with a prayer.
Here we have the all-day prayers.
That we be shown all through the day what our next step is to be. That we be given whatever we need to take care of such problems. We ask especially for freedom of self-will and are careful to make no requests for ourselves only. We may ask for ourselves, however, if others will be helped.
Another warning.
We are careful never to pray for our own selfish ends. Many of us have wasted a lot of time doing that, and it doesn't work. You can easily see why.
Next paragraph, we have some options for step 11.
If circumstances warrant, we ask our wives or friend to join us in the morning meditation. If we belong to a religious denomination, which requires a definite morning devotion, we attend to that also. It's not members of religious bodies. We sometimes select and memorize a few set prayers, which emphasize the principles that we have been discussing. There are many helpful books also. Suggestions about these may be obtained from one's priest, minister, or rabbi. Make use of what they offer.
So pray, read, write, and get advice. More directions and another timeline. Last paragraph, same page.
As we go through the day, we pause when agitated or doubtful.
The doubter's prayer.
And we ask for the right thought or action.
A requirement.
We constantly remind ourselves we are no longer running the show.
The all-purpose prayer.
Humbly saying to ourselves many times each day, thy will be done.
Another promise.
We are then in much less danger of excitement, fear, anger, worry, self-pity, or foolish decisions. We become more and more efficient. We do not tire so easily, for we are not burning up energy foolishly as we did when we were trying to arrange life to suit ourselves.
Next line, we have a major promise for step 11.
It works. It really does.
Next line, we have a major fact for us alcoholics.
We alcoholics are undisciplined.
Really? Same line, we have the major requirement to sobriety.
So we let God discipline us in the simple way we have just outlined.
Next line, we find the timeline to step 12. Also, a major warning to sobriety.
But this is not all. There is action and more action. Faith without works is dead. The next chapter is entirely devoted to step 12.
In summary, step 11 is an exclusive relationship with God, a life of prayer and meditation. Step 11 equips us to live in harmony with and to rightly relate ourselves to God and to our fellows. Step 11 also prepares us to walk through the principles of awareness and belief, to be of some value to some drunk along the line. Study this book. Don't just read it. It gives us clear-cut directions on how to find the power, on how to use the power, on how to keep the power that is greater than us, God. Let's take step 11 together. We will have a moment of silent meditation and listen for God's guidance, that quiet voice, God's message. Let's have 1 minute of silence, please. That's step 11. Now let's look at step 12 and listen as Michael reads step 12 from the 1944 pamphlet.
Step 12. Having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs.
This step logically separates us into three parts. Part number one, the spiritual experience.
The terms spiritual experience and spiritual awakening, used here and in the book Alcoholics Anonymous, mean, upon careful reading, that the personality change sufficient to bring about recovery from alcoholism has manifested itself among us in many forms. Now listen, do not get the impression that these personality changes or spiritual experiences must be in the nature of a sudden and spectacular upheavals. Happily for everyone, this conclusion is erroneous. Among our rapidly growing membership of thousands of alcoholics, such transformations, though frequent, are by no means the rule. Most of our experiences are what the psychologist William James calls of the educational variety, because they develop slowly over a period of time. Quite often, friends of the newcomer are aware of the difference long before he is himself. The new man gradually realizes that he's undergone profound alteration in his reaction to life, that such a change could hardly have been brought about by himself alone. What often takes place in a few months could seldom have been accomplished by years of self-discipline. With few exceptions, our members find that they have tapped an unsuspected inner resource which they presently identify with their own conception of a power greater than ourselves. Most emphatically, we wish to say that any alcoholic capable of honestly facing his problem in the light of our experience can recover, provided he does not close his mind to all spiritual concepts. He can only be defeated by an attitude of intolerance or belligerent denial. We find that no one need have difficulty with the spiritual principles. Willingness, honesty, and open-mindedness are the essentials of recovery, but these are indispensable.
Part number two. Carry the message to others.
This means exactly what it says. Carry the message actively. Bring it to the man who needs it. We do it in many ways.
And here we have 11 requirements to follow. A.
By attending every meeting of our own group.
B.
By making calls.
C.
By speaking at group meetings.
D.
By supporting our group financially to make the group meeting possible.
E.
By assisting at meetings.
F.
By sending a good example of complete sobriety.
G.
By owning and loaning to newcomers a copy of the AA Big Book.
H.
By encouraging those who find the way difficult.
I.
By serving as an officer or on group committees or special assignment when asked.
J.
By doing all the foregoing cheerfully and willingly.
Okay.
We do all the foregoing at some sacrifice to ourselves with definite thought of developing unselfishness in our own character.
Part number three. We practice these principles in all our affairs.
This last part of the 12th step is the real purpose that all of the 12 steps lead to, a new way of life. It's a design for living. It shows how to live rightly, think rightly, and to achieve happiness.
How do we go about it? Here we have 7 components for sobriety. A.
We resolve to live our lives one day at a time, just 24 hours.
B.
We pray each day for guidance that day.
C.
We pray each night for thanks for that day.
D.
We resolve to keep our heads and to forego any anger no matter what situation arises.
E.
We are patient.
F.
We keep calm, relaxed.
G.
Now, and most important, whatever little ordinary situation as well as big situation arises, we look at it calmly and fairly with an open mind, then act on it in exact accordance with the simple true principles that AA has taught and will teach us. In other words, our sobriety is only a correction of our worst and most evident faults. Our living each day according to the principles of AA will also correct all of our other lesser faults and will gradually eliminate one by one all of the defects in our character that cause friction, discontent, and unhappy rebellious moods that lead right back to our chief fault of drinking. Let's go to page 89, line 1, and the book tells us of some more promises to look forward to as we continue to build our way to a daily reprieve. The 12-step promises on page 89, line 1.
Here the book tells us the major requirement for sobriety, which just happened to be a major promise for sobriety. Beginning on page 89, line 1, in chapter 7, Working with Others.
Practical experience shows that nothing will do so much to ensure immunity from drinking as intensive work with other alcoholics.
Followed by another major promise.
It works when others' activities fail.
The directions read,
this is our 12th suggestion. Carry this message to other alcoholics.
What message? The chapter, the doctor's opinion, and the first 103 pages of this book. Let's read the rest of the 12-step promises, continued with line 5.
You can help when no one else can. You can secure their confidence when others fail. Remember, they are very ill. Life will take on new meaning. To watch people recover, to see them help others, to watch loneliness vanish, to see a fellowship grow about you, to have a host of friends. This is the experience you must not miss. We know you will not want to miss it. Frequent contact with newcomers and with each other is the bright spot of our lives.
The rest of this chapter is clear-cut directions on how to work with other alcoholics. It's a sponsor's guide. Let's take a look at the directions. They are very clear, so when you get out to work with other alcoholics, you'll be armed with the facts. Let's begin on this same page, line 23. Here we have a major fact and some major requirements for step 12.
Because of your own drinking experience, you can be uniquely useful to other alcoholics. So cooperate, never criticize. To be helpful is our only aim.
Go to page 90, line 1, and continue to read and study step 12.
Again, that's page 90, line 1, and it reads,
when you discover a prospect for Alcoholics Anonymous, find out all you can about him. If he does not want to stop drinking, don't waste time trying to persuade him. He may spoil a later opportunity.
It's been said, and whatever gets your attention first gets you. So we just plant the seed. And realize, at least, you've ruined their drinking. Go to line 12.
Put yourself in his place to see how you would like to him to approach you if the tables were turned.
Each and every alcoholic, sober or not, teaches us very valuable lessons about ourselves and about our own personal recovery. Carrying the message is always a win-win situation. We have nothing to lose except our egotism, so humbly, and gratefully, we considerately carry AA's message. We go to the last paragraph.
If he does not want to see you, never force yourself upon him.
We carry the message. We don't force it. Some of us change when we see the light. Most of us change when we feel the heat. Go to page 91, line 18.
See your man alone, if possible. At first, engage in general conversation. After a while, turn the talk to some phase of drinking. Tell him enough about your drinking habits, symptoms, and experiences to encourage him to speak of himself. If he wishes to talk, let him do so.
We gain their confidence. Remember that the one who makes light of things is least likely to stumble around in the dark. Go to page 92, line 1.
Page 92, line 1, and it reads,
Tell him how baffled you were, how you finally learned that you were sick. Give him an account of the struggles you made to stop. Show him the mental twist which leads to the first drink of a spree.
We share our story. We tell of the obsession of the mind and the insanity of the first drink. It's been said that an alcoholic is like a whiskey bottle, all neck and belly and no head. Interesting analogy, isn't it? And go to line 15.
And be careful not to brand him an alcoholic. Let him draw his own conclusion.
Prospects learn self-honesty in their own time. Remember, recovery is an inside job. Go to line 21.
Speak of alcoholism as an illness, a fatal malady. Talk about the conditions of the body and mind which accompany it.
We tell of the allergy, the obsession, and the phenomenon of craving, that alcoholism is an illness, an affliction, and a malady which carries over into sobriety. Go to page 93, line 3.
Again, page 93, line 3, and it reads,
tell him exactly what happened to you. Stress the spiritual feature freely. If the man be agnostic or atheist, make it emphatic that he does not have to agree with your conception of God. He can choose any conception he likes, provided it makes sense to him. The main thing is that he be willing to believe in a power greater than himself, and that he live by spiritual principles.
Remember, it is easier to stay out of a situation than it is to get out of a situation. So we stay out of controversy. Go to page 94, line 4.
Outline the program of action. Explain how we made a self-appraisal, how you straightened out your past, and why you are now endeavoring to be helpful to him. It is important for him to realize that your attempt to pass this on to him plays a vital role in your own recovery.
We talk of the steps, the solution, and our honest motives. Realize this. Eventually, every alcoholic takes their last drink. Those of us in AA, sober, have lived to tell others about it. Go to the last paragraph.
Your candidate may give good reasons why he need not follow all of the program. He may rebel at the thought of a drastic house cleaning which requires discussion with other people. Do not contradict such views, telling him you once felt about as he does, but you doubt whether you would have made much progress had you not taken some action.
When we first came to AA, we heard people talking about things that we personally were trying to keep everyone else from finding out about. Go to page 95, line 8.
Again, page 95, line 8, and it reads,
you will be most successful with alcoholics if you do not exhibit any passion for crusade or reform. Never talk down to an alcoholic from any moral or spiritual hilltop. Simply lay out the kit of spiritual tools for this inspection. Show him how they work for you. Offer him friendship and fellowship. Tell him that if he wants to get well, you will do anything to help.
We don't lecture. What? We don't lecture. We look them in the eye, give them a copy of the big book, and tell them your story. Take them to meetings. The only time we look down at another alcoholic is when we are bending over to help them up. Go to the next paragraph.
If he is not interested in your solution, if he expects you to act only as a banker for financial difficulties or a nurse for his sprees, you may have to drop him until he changes his mind.
We do not enable. When we first came to AA, we knew the price of everything, but the value of absolutely nothing. Go to the last paragraph.
If he thinks he can do the job in some other way, or prefers some other spiritual approach, encourage him to follow his own conscience.
We support and encourage them. From page 31, line 12. If anyone who is showing inability to control his drinking can do the right about face and drink like a gentleman, our hats are off to him. And just for a personal note, we've taken our hats off at many a gravesite. Go to page 96, line 4.
Page 96, line 4. We find it a waste of time to keep chasing a man who cannot or will not work with you.
Sponsorship is a two-way street. Cooperation is essential. Remember that sometimes prospects just get homesick for hell. Go to line 16.
He has read this volume and says he's prepared to go through with the 12 steps of the program of recovery. Having had experience yourself, you can give him much practical advice. Let him know you are available if he wishes to make a decision and tell his story. But do not insist upon it if he prefers to consult with someone else.
We offer them temporary sponsorship. Back when we were drinking, we didn't care much who we drank with. It's ironic that we can be particular about who we get sober with. Go to page 97, line 3.
Page 97, line 3, and it reads,
never avoid these responsibilities, but be sure you are doing the right thing if you assume them. Helping others is the foundation stone of your recovery.
Ask yourself, is it helpful or harmful? Remember this, when I help another dig their way out of their own trouble, the hole that is left over is the grave for my own sorrow. Go to line 25.
Though an alcoholic does not respond, there is no reason why you should neglect his family.
Alcoholism has many faces, many casualties. It is a family illness. Besides, our aim is only to be helpful, not conditional. Go to page 98, line 2.
And on page 98, line 2, it reads,
the men who cry for money and shelter before conquering alcohol are on the wrong track.
This is the wrong approach. From page 64, lines 27 and 28, when the spiritual malady is overcome, we straighten out mentally and physically. Go to line 8.
It is not the matter of giving that is in question, but when and how to give. That often makes the difference between failure and success. Learn the truth. Job or no job, wife or no wife, we simply do not stop drinking so long as we place dependence upon other people ahead of our dependence on God. Burn the idea into the consciousness of every man that we can get well regardless of anyone. The only condition is that we trust in God and clean house.
This is the right track. From page 52, lines 26 and 27, our ideas did not work, but the God idea did. Think about this. For most alcoholics, Skid Row is between their ears. Go to page 99, line 10.
And on page 99, line 10, it reads,
these things will come to pass naturally, and in good time provided. However, the alcoholic continues to demonstrate that he can be sober, considerate, and helpful, regardless of what anyone says or does.
We tell them that it takes time and don't give up before the miracle happens. Besides, we didn't get drunk with everyone out there, so we're not going to get sober with everyone in here. Go to the last line on this page.
Remind the prospect that his recovery is not dependent upon people, it is dependent upon his relationship with God.
God is everything. He is the solution. Period. Go to line 5.
Both you and the new man must walk day by day in the path of spiritual progress. If you persist, remarkable things will happen.
What we just read is one of the finest descriptions of sponsorship in this book. Food for thought. If you want to leave footprints in the sand, be sure to wear your work boots. Go to the last paragraph.
Assuming we are spiritually fit, we can do all sorts of things alcoholics are not supposed to do.
From page 85, lines 16, 17, and 18, what we really have is a daily reprieve contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition. We are recovered. Go to page 101, line 7.
Again, page 101, line 7, and it reads,
we meet these conditions every day. An alcoholic who cannot meet them still has an alcoholic mind. There is something the matter with his spiritual status.
We change ourselves to meet life situations. It is not the other way around. Remember always that our problems occur from the inside out. It's been said that if you find yourself in a hole, all you need to do is stop digging.
Put the shovel down.
Go to line 23. So our rule is not to avoid a place when there is drinking, if we have a legitimate reason for being there.
Anyone can get drunk. It takes effort to be an alcoholic. The point is that we are pursuing spiritual principles and motives in step 12. Ask yourself, is it God will, good will, or is it my will, ill will? Go to page 102, line 3.
Go to page 102, line 3, and it reads,
but be sure you are on solid spiritual ground before you start, and that your motive is going in thoroughly good. Do not think of what you will get out of the occasion. Think of what you can bring to it. But if you are shaky, you had better work with another alcoholic instead.
The difference between a stumbling block and a stepping stone is how you use it. Think about it. Go to line 23.
Your job now is to be in the place where you may be of maximum helpfulness to others. So never hesitate to go anywhere if you can be helpful. You should not hesitate to visit the most sordid spot on earth or such an errand. Keep on the firing line of life, where these motives of God will keep you unharmed.
Let's consider this analogy of AA's program of recovery from alcoholism. We made an application for the jobs in steps 1, 2, and 3. We made a resume for the job in step 4. We made an interview for the job in step 5. We made a trial period of employment for the job in steps 6, 7, 8, and 9. And now our job description is steps 10, 11, and 12 daily, the daily reprieve. The job title, recovered alcoholic. The place of employment, the firing line of life. And the job, sobriety. Go to page 103, line 3.
That's on page 103, line 3, and it reads,
we are careful never to show intolerance or hatred of drinking as an institution. Experience shows that such an attitude is not helpful to anyone. Every new alcoholic looks for this spirit among us and is immensely relieved when he finds that we are not witch-burning.
We are all, as recovered alcoholics, living examples of spiritual principles, ideals, and attitudes. We are, each individual, AA. We are God's loving advisors and loving sponsors. The definition of what AA is all about is simply the art of helping another alcoholic to grow up without putting them down. Let's continue studying line 14.
Someday, we hope that Alcoholics Anonymous will help the public to a better realization of the gravity of the alcoholic problem. But we shall be of little use of our attitude if one is bitterness or hostility. Drinkers will not stand for it. After all, our problems were of our own making. Bottles were only a symbol. Besides, we have stopped fighting anybody or anything. We have to.
Remember always that alcoholism comes in people, not in bottles. So, as members of AA, it is our duty to carry AA's message that is in this book and to keep the message pure. There's more than meets the eye when it comes to alcoholism. Be careful, carry AA's message and not your own mess. Just another bit of food for thought. The difference between us and God is that God doesn't try to play us. Now let's have some final thoughts about AA program of recovery. Go to page 164, line 12, and here we will find a major promise to our sobriety.
Again, that is page 164, line 12, and it reads,
God will constantly disclose more to you and to us.
Followed by the 12th step prayer.
Ask him in your morning meditation what you can do each day for the man who is still sick.
Next, we have a major promise and some warnings to the daily reprieve, the fit spiritual condition.
The answers will come if your own house is in order.
And next, a major warning to step 10.
But obviously, you cannot transmit something you haven't got.
Followed by a major warning to step 11.
See to it that your relationship with him is right.
Here we have another major promise to step 12.
And great events will come to pass for you and countless others. This is the great fact for us.
Now, the next paragraph contains the whole deal. The timeline requirements, directions, and explanations of sobriety. Step 11, which reads,
abandon yourself to God as you understand God.
Next is step 10, which reads,
admit your faults to Him and to your fellows. Clear away the wreckage of your past.
And step 12, which reads,
give freely of what you find and join us.
And here we are given AA's final promise.
We shall be with you in the fellowship of the Spirit, and you will surely meet some of us as you trudge the road of happy destiny.
And the last line is a simple AA prayer, and our hope for all of you.
May God bless you and keep you until then.
This is step 12, the principles of love and service to God and our fellows. This is the highest level of living. Nothing is higher. This is the main reason for our existence. This is why we have been spared. We have what the next alcoholic needs, the kind of love that has no price tag. On page 132 in chapter 9, The Family Afterwards.
Again, that's page 132, chapter 9, and it reads,
we have been speaking to you of serious, sometimes tragic things. We have been dealing with alcohol in its worst aspect. But we aren't a glum lot. If newcomers could see no joy or fun in our existence, they wouldn't want it.
And here is another main requirement for sobriety.
We absolutely insist on enjoying life.
Let's continue. Here we have a major requirement to Alcoholics Anonymous. That states simply, we, as Alcoholics Anonymous, have one purpose, one requirement, one message, one reason, and one single responsibility. And that deals with alcoholics and alcoholism only, period.
We do not indulge in cynicism over the state of the nation, nor do we carry the world's troubles on our shoulders. When we see a man sinking into the mire that is alcoholism, we give him first aid and place what we have at his disposal. For his sake, we do not recount and almost relive the horrors of our past.
Next, we have a major warning for the individual member that says, we cannot be all things to all people.
But those of us who have tried to shoulder the entire burden and trouble of others find we are soon overcome by them.
Next paragraph, some requirements.
So we think cheerfulness and laughter make for usefulness. Outsiders are sometimes shocked when we burst into merriment over a seemingly tragic experience out of the past. But why shouldn't we laugh?
Consider this equation when it comes to sobriety. Tragedy plus time equals comedy.
Tragedy plus time equals comedy.
That's right. Look at my life. Continue reading. Next line. Here we have the big payoff.
We have recovered and been given the power to help others.
Let's read this again.
We have recovered and have been given the power to help others.
Continue the last paragraph, a fact, a requirement.
Everyone knows that those in bad health and those who seldom play do not laugh much. So let each family play together or separately, as much as their circumstances warrant.
Another main requirement.
We are sure God wants us to be happy, joyous, and free.
Warning, and the bottom line to our personal recovery.
We cannot subscribe to the belief that this life is a veil of tears, though it once was just that for many of us. But it is clear that we made our own misery. God didn't do it.
A final requirement that says adversity is our greatest teacher, and that these are 12 steps to God.
Avoid then the deliberate manufacture of misery. But if trouble comes, cheerfully capitalize it into an opportunity to just demonstrate his omnipotence.
Go to page 25, line 4, to sum up the AA's program of recovery. This summary says it all.
And that was on page 25, line 4, in chapter 2, there is a solution.
There is a solution. Almost none of us like the self-searching and the leveling of our pride, the confession of shortcomings, which the process requires for its successful consummation. But we saw that it really worked in others, and we had come to believe in the hopelessness and futility of life as we had been living it. When, therefore, we were approached by those in whom the problem had been solved,
there was nothing left for us to do but to pick up the simple kit of spiritual tools laid at our feet. Continue reading, line 13.
We have found much of heaven, and we have been rocketed into a fourth dimension of existence, of which we have not even dreamed. The great fact is just this, and nothing less, that we have had deep and effective spiritual experiences which have revolutionized our whole attitudes toward life, toward our fellows, and towards God's universe. The central fact of our life today is the absolute certainty that our Creator has entered into our hearts and lives in a way which is indeed miraculous. He has commenced to accomplish those things for us which we could never do by ourselves.
Welcome to each of you who have completed the 12 steps. Congratulations. May God bless you and keep you as you trudge the road of happy destiny. Homework for this class is to read and discuss with your sponsor pages 84 through 103. If you have any questions, comments, or points of discussion, talk with your sponsor or God.
Thank you for attending. And we have one special note of thanks to Brian for putting this thing together.
Cool.
Yeah.
We hope you have enjoyed going through the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous with us. We are a regular meeting that meets on Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. in Tacoma, Washington. We meet in the basement of the First Congregational Church, 209 South J Street. If you're ever in the neighborhood, we'd love to have you stop by. We close the meeting by observing the seventh tradition. We stand, we bow our heads, we do not hold hands, with no sayings or slogans at the end. We just say the Lord's Prayer, followed by a moment of silence. Thank you for taking the time to listen.